time for Flight 11. As always, when SpaceX releases the latest launch updates, they also provide additional insight into the mission, outlining the stages that comprise the full flight schedule. This is an ideal opportunity to summarize all the information into one concise overview, so you can follow along smoothly, enjoy the launch, and take note of the important milestones. Let's discuss it all in today's episode of NR Studio. As previously mentioned, Starship Flight 11 is scheduled for October 13th. This date isn't just a random point in time, it holds significant historical relevance. A year ago, on the same date, SpaceX conducted Starship Flight 5, which was a significant milestone in the program's evolution. That particular launch was historic because it marked the first instance in which SpaceX successfully completed a full burn of a Starship upper stage. Now, 1 year later, on the same date, Flight 11 is preparing for its journey. This launch timing seems to suggest that SpaceX may be working towards another significant milestone, which seems to create a meaningful connection between these two missions. The launch is scheduled for precisely 6:15 p.m. Central Time. The importance of this launch timing is that it allows both components, the Super Heavy booster and Starship's upper stage, to land in daylight, meaning viewers will have the opportunity to observe every maneuver in detail. This clarity heightens the excitement for viewers worldwide who have been closely following Starship's development. As with all major launches, a series of systematic actions precede the launch. If the launch is scheduled for 6:15 p.m., live coverage will likely begin about 30 minutes earlier, allowing viewers to witness the thrilling fueling process and receive updates directly from the SpaceX crew. However, long before ignition occurs, preparations are underway behind the scenes. At 1 hour and 15 minutes before launch, the flight director will officially verify and confirm clearance for propellant loading. This important milestone marks the beginning of a stunning visual spectacle at the launch site, as the giant storage tanks, the orbital launch pad, the integration tower, and the rocket itself begin to release gases. The billowing clouds of methane and oxygen create what many fans describe as a captivating and almost surreal sight, signaling the rocket's start to activate. At exactly 53 minutes, liquid methane begins flowing into the tanks in Starship's upper stage. Shortly thereafter, at 45 minutes, liquid oxygen flows back in, cooling the tanks and preparing the spacecraft for its mission. A similar procedure occurs on the Super Heavy booster, albeit in a slightly different manner.
At approximately 41 and 30 minutes, liquid methane is transferred to the booster's large tanks, followed by the addition of liquid oxygen at 33 minutes. During this period, the rocket engines also undergo a procedure called engine cooldown. During this phase, extremely cold cryogenic fuel begins circulating through the Raptor engine's pipes and turbopumps. The reasoning behind this process is simple yet vital. The significant temperature difference between room temperature components and the cryogenic fuel causes what engineers call a thermal shock. By pre-cooling the engines with cold fuel, SpaceX reduces structural stress and ensures that the engines will ignite successfully when the countdown's over. Once fueling is complete, Starship and Super Heavy reach a state of full readiness. At approximately 3 and 30 minutes and again at 2 and 50 minutes, the fuel lines are secured and the tanks are pressurized. At this point, the spacecraft is fully fueled and ready to unleash its incredible power. However, preparation alone is not enough. The final decision rests with the flight director, who must perform final checks and authorize the launch at approximately T-minus 40 seconds. It is at this point that viewers may observe a brief pause in the countdown as all systems are checked one last time. When the flight director gives the go-ahead, excitement builds. 10 seconds before liftoff, the water deluge system activates, raining thousands of gallons of water onto the OLM. This procedure is crucial because it protects ground systems from the extreme heat and sound energy generated by the simultaneous firing of all 33 Raptor engines. Typically, the crowd begins a collective countdown at this point, with anticipation building both on the live stream and at the launch site. At T-minus 3 seconds, the Raptor engines begin their ignition sequence. In sequence, all 33 engines ignite as sensors verify full thrust. Clamps release, and the 400-foot-tall rocket begins its ascent into the sky. The sound of liftoff is an unmistakable marker that signals the beginning of a new chapter in the Starship narrative. The ascent to space is marked by a significant milestone. At 1 minute and 2 seconds into the flight, Starship crosses Max Q, the moment of maximum aerodynamic stress. This is when the rocket experiences the highest structural stress due to the competing forces of speed and atmospheric density. Successfully passing Max-Q always brings a sense of relief to engineers and spectators alike. Approximately 2 minutes and 30 seconds after liftoff, the next crucial event occurs, known as stage separation. The outer and middle rings of booster engines shut down in a phase called main engine cutoff, or MECO for short. Only the three central engines continue to operate, providing enough thrust to stabilize the booster. At the same time, the engines on the upper stage ignite due to the assistance of the hot staging ring. Starship separates from the booster, commencing its orbital journey while the Super Heavy prepares for its return trip. Let us first track the Super Heavy. Almost instantly after separation, the booster performs a boost back burn. 13 engines roar to life, meticulously adjusting the vehicle's alignment and path for its anticipated return. This burn endures for nearly a full minute before the engines shut down consecutively and the hot staging ring is discarded. Following this, the booster enters freefall for several minutes. At 6 minutes and 20 seconds into the flight, the landing burn is initiated. This phase relies on both the inner and middle ring engines functioning together to decelerate and steer the large rocket. As the height drops below 1 kilometer, most engines are turned off, with only a few remaining active to manage the exact final descent. For this particular flight, SpaceX intends to tweak the setup. Rather than dropping down to just 3 engines, the booster will maintain 5 operational engines, presumably 3 inner ones and 2 middle engines to enhance control. Once stability is reached, the system will reduce back to the standard 3 engine configuration. By using gimballing, Super Heavy will manage both its position and angle as it nears the landing area. The booster is expected to gently land in the Gulf, completing its mission segment. In the meantime, Starship keeps moving forward. Its engines continue to burn until the upper stage reaches orbit, ultimately shutting down at 8 minutes and 57 seconds into the flight. After this moment, Starship experiences a calm cruise until the next significant milestone, satellite deployment. 18 minutes after launch, the payload doors open and the dispenser goes to work. For Flight 11, SpaceX has again opted to deploy 8 simulated satellites. These test payloads act as a practice run for future actual deployments. The dispenser precisely adjusts each satellite, raising the lowest ones until they line up with the door. The system then gradually releases each satellite into space one by one. This operation lasts for 7 minutes and wraps up at the 25-minute mark. SpaceX has successfully carried out this procedure before, but each repetition enhances assurance for upcoming operational missions. At 37 minutes and 48 seconds into the flight, a single Raptor engine fires up again. This action illustrates the capacity to restart in space, an essential ability for missions to higher orbits, lunar explorations, and more. Once confirmed, the mission shifts into its most dangerous phase, re-entry. At 47 minutes and 29 seconds, Starship dives back into Earth's atmosphere. The heat shield tiles on its underside experience immense strain as plasma envelops the craft. Interestingly, SpaceX has purposefully removed certain tiles on this mission, exposing sensitive regions to assess the system under extreme conditions. This represents one of the most tense moments of the mission as engineers collect crucial information regarding the shield's effectiveness. At approximately the 1 hour mark in the flight, Starship began to decelerate to transonic speeds. Instead of heading directly toward its landing target, the spacecraft performed agile banked maneuvers, assessing its subsonic navigation system. This experimental phase reenacted the complex route Starship would eventually take upon returning to Starbase for a controlled terrestrial landing. Finally, at 1 hour, 6 minutes, and 14 seconds after launch, Starship shifted from a horizontal to an upright position. 3 engines at sea level fired to reduce speed and carefully steer the craft toward the ocean. As it approached the surface, the engines shut down and Starship made a gentle emergency landing at 1 hour, 6 minutes, and 30 seconds. This event would mark the end of Flight 11's ambitious endeavor. If all went according to plan, that day would mark not only another experiment, but also a significant moment of progress for humanity's journey into the cosmos. Each segment, from liftoff to reentry, represented years of extensive engineering effort, coupled with countless hours of tireless commitment. It's important to recognize that Starship Flight 11 was no ordinary test. This mission serves as both a farewell to the legacy system and a rehearsal for what's to come.
Unique features make this mission significant, each providing insight into how SpaceX is progressively improving Starship for future generations and additional missions. First, neither stage will perform a tower capture maneuver. Instead, S-37 and B-15 will end their missions with emergency landings. This strategic choice allows SpaceX to focus on maximizing performance and data collection rather than recovery efforts. Both vehicles are on their final flights, giving engineers the opportunity to gain as much knowledge as possible before transitioning to a new design ready for recovery at Starbase. Second, there will be increased scrutiny of the B-15 engines. During Flight 10, a failure in the center ring engine highlighted their critical role in the ascent and landing combustion. Flight 11 increases the challenge because 24 of the 33 Raptor engines on Booster 15 are being reused. While undergoing a thorough inspection, this evaluation will demonstrate how SpaceX can reuse the rocket while ensuring its reliability. Third, the vehicle's experience during Max-Q is a subtle but significant benchmark. Previous missions have shown that the stresses encountered here can have downstream effects, indirectly influencing subsequent events. The performance of the upper stage may be affected by how Flight 11 manages this phase. Fourth, this mission will be the last to jettison the hot staging ring. SpaceX has successfully executed this maneuver 8 times, but this contradicts the principle of reusability. Starting with version 3, hot staging will be integrated directly into Super Heavy, eliminating the need to jettison hardware into the ocean. Fifth, the booster's landing profile has been modified. Instead of switching directly from 13 engines to 3, Flight 11 will alternate between 13 engines, then 5, and finally 3. This strategy introduces a degree of redundancy, allowing the booster to adapt if one or two engines fail. It serves as an important rehearsal for V3-related recovery operations. On the upper stage, the spacecraft will perform a simulated return trajectory, similar to a prospective landing at Starbase. This test run is crucial for refining navigation, handling, and atmospheric adjustment. That's it for today's episode. See you in the next time.